So I want to welcome everyone. My name is Charles Chavis. I'm Director of African and African American Studies at George Mason University. I'm indeed honored to be here for the W.E.B. DuBois Lecture Series. This series is as old as our program, I believe. We have some elder scholars here who can give us the exact date and timeline. But we're indeed honored to continue this tradition of bridging the intellectual tradition, Black tradition, to the contemporary. And we're honored today to be joined by Dr. Jeff Ogbar. And I'll be giving Dr. Ogbar's background in a few seconds. But the topic for this year's lecture is, we gonna be hip-hop and social justice. So we can go ahead and get started. I'll just briefly read Professor Ogbar's biography. The short version, I think it was about 3 pages, Doc. but I'll condense it, and then from there we'll go ahead and get started. Jeffrey O.G. Ogbar is professor of history and the founding director of the Center for the Study of Popular Music. Prior to his role, he served as the University of Connecticut's Vice Provost for Diversity and Chief Diversity Officer. Dr. Ogbar served as Associate Dean for the Humanities in the College of Liberal Arts and Sciences from 2009 to 2012, and as Director of the Institute of African American Studies from 2003 to 2009. He is the author of Black Power, Radical Politics and African American Identity with Johns Hopkins University Press, which was the winner of an outstanding academic title from Choice. His book, Hip Hop Revolution, The Culture and Politics of Rap, which is the book that he'll be discussing and lecturing from today, was published in the fall of 2007, and he is also the winner, interestingly enough, of the W.E.B. Du Bois Book Prize from the Northeast Black Studies Association. He is currently working on his newest book, A History of White Nationalism in Shaping Atlanta, for Basic Books. Without further ado, please join me in welcoming Dr. Jeffrey Ogbar.
Is it afternoon yet? Yes, it is. We're an hour and 15 minutes into the afternoon, so happy afternoon, everyone. Good afternoon. It's a pleasure to be here. It is it's always good to come to different parts of the country and enjoy the provincial expressions and food. This is like one of my things. And so usually when I get to the Chesapeake area, I gravitate to seafood and crab cakes in particular. And so last night, I benefited from the generosity of some of the faculty here at the university. We went out, and while the food wasn't the biggest point of the night, we had raucous laughter, we had joy and stories to tell for a very long time, and all kind of questions about our athleticism, which was a surprise to everyone who was there, but stories to tell for years. And I was telling my wife about the hospitality last night, and she said, well, if they're that hospitable, you need to make sure you don't disappoint today, you know? So I will do my best not to disappoint you today. So thank you so much for hospitality. And I hope to leave you satisfied. Just to frame our conversation today, it will be a conversation around social justice and hip hop, but it's gonna be a little broader than hip hop. And I wanna set this up, and hopefully it will be a informative talk that will have us kind of think about how we imagine the role of music in general. And when we think about the role of music in particular, it seems apt that we would start with a quote from the most celebrated and consequential scholar of the 20th century, Dr. W.E.B. Du Bois, whom this lecture is named after. And Du Bois was one who was he was observant of so many different phenomena in the world, in the Black community, and beyond the African-American community. But one of the things he talked about was music. So this seminal book, 1903, he talked about art, and he talked about music, talked about politics, and a lot of different things in the souls of Black folk. But this is what he said about music. He said, I know little of music, and I can say nothing in technical phrase, but I know something of men. And knowing them, I know that these songs are the articulate message of the slave to the world. And what he was doing at this point was talking about the music African Americans had created and what had been known as sort of field songs or slave songs or Negro spirituals. And so for him, as a New Englander from Great Barrington, Massachusetts, who had come to the South and went to Fisk University, and then went to rural Tennessee, and then went to rural Alabama, then rural Georgia, and he saw so many things. And at this point, he's about 30 years old, I think. Actually, the math here is born with 1868. So at this point, he's still a young man. He's seen so much in his lifetime, in his 30s at this point. And what I want to say is that when you think a little bit more what Du Bois said, by the time he published this, these songs that became known as sorrow songs, or again spirituals, they had become a part of the American popular canon when it came to songs. And in his essays for this book, he entered each essay with an epigraph from one of these songs. And he entered the songs through new literary and scholarly canon in his own way. He even divided society in a divided society following the U.S. government's disinvestment in Reconstruction and the sharp uptick of lynching and other forms of racial terror, these Negro folk songs could not help but have a profound impact, quote, as the most beautiful expression of human experience born this side of the seas. So this is what Du Bois says, the most beautiful expression of the human condition born this side of the seas. And so this is really kind of interesting for him to talk about music at this point in what historians call the nadir, this low point in the African-American experience, being exposed to all sorts of horrors and terrors. So when we think about someone as a giant as Du Bois, as someone who's an activist and also a scholar, we think about the other sort of icon of freedom and activism, of course, would be Dr. Martin Luther King, right? Another person who's a PhD, someone who actually did teach at a university, well, at a college, taught at Morehouse College for a second, and considered when he got his PhD to go in academia, but was called to the pulpit. So instead of the lectern, he went to the pulpit, but he found himself in many ways engaged in intellectual work, even as he was engaged in activism. And so he was also drawn to commentary around music. So at his point, the songs that were popular were songs around jazz and blues. And so what did King say about jazz and blues? The interesting thing is that there's one point of him actually that we have on record talking about this music, and it's 1964 Berlin Jazz Festival, and this is what he says here. We have him saying that God has wrought, and this is kind of interesting because he's pulling together, right, spiritual and secular, in the way that Du Bois brought in spiritual and secular from a different angle, right? So Du Bois, as a secularist, is commentating on spiritual music, while here we have someone in the pulpit talking about secular music. God has wrought many things out of oppression. He's endowed his creators with the capacity to create and form. This capacity has flowed the sweetest songs of sorrow and joy that have allowed man to cope with his environment and many different situations. Jazz speaks for life. The blues tell the story of life's difficulties. And if you think for a moment, you will realize that they take the hardest realities of life and put them into music, only to come out with some new hope or a sense of triumph. This, Dr. King says, is triumphant music. So when he talks about the travails of the social political conditions out of which blues emerges, and it comes out of the place where my great-grandparents are from, where Dr. Whitlock's ancestors are from, in Mississippi. You think about Mississippi as a place of, and I tell my students that there's probably in the early 20th century, there's probably no place in the Western Hemisphere that is more inhospitable to human life than what black people experience in Mississippi Delta, right? And so my students are like, well, you know, what do you mean? I'm like, so what makes the Mississippi Delta so bad? I'm talking about the Western Hemisphere, Haiti included, right? And you know, people talk about the poorest country in Haiti. I say, well, you know, these people had absolute poverty, no electricity, no running water, no paved roads, no access to high schools, no sense of justice. You can't vote. It's not like they had, you know, access to democracy, right? But what Haiti didn't have and what Colombia didn't have or Panama or Brazilian rainforest, they didn't have terrorist organizations that would just come by if they just will, right? And just they could rape, plunder, burn your whole city down and go home and go to sleep without any sort of recourse at all. Those things might happen with the state action oppressing people, not so much just random neighbors down the street just decide to come and burn down your church, right? So this is a very, very inhospitable place, pressing poverty, and out of that comes the blues. And Dr. King talks about the blues, but he talks about the blues in a context where this music, like Du Bois said earlier, becomes a space for some critical examination of the world in which we live, and also a sort of resistive expression in some way. So if we go up a little bit, I want to kind of think about social justice, looking at Du Bois and King's context, and I want to look at social justice. So social justice can take many different forms and look many different ways. But I want to look in particular at the modern civil rights movement. And I don't want to focus, we know that King is not the sole representative of the modern civil rights movement. King is one of, you know, many different leaders. We have national leaders, we have state, we have local leaders. We have people who are ideologically in contest with each other. We have organizations that inside the organizations, there's internecine ideological conflict. So the movement is not ideologically monolithic, right? There are different tactics and everything. But let's look at these pillars as an expression of what King talked about, right? So this is just one expression, right? We have his notions of nonviolence, and then we're gonna see the degree to which hip hop in recent years might align to some of this stuff here and what we've seen in Black Lives Matter and some other spaces. One is that, and this resonates to some of our conversation last night, we talked about African Americans engaged in forms of self-defense 100 years ago during DuBois' time in Atlanta, for example, where African-American elites and working people and poor people had to arm themselves against mobs of terrorists who had come to burn down their communities. And so this idea of self-defense was there. And some people read King's turn the other cheek, or what I call rejection of direct action self-defense. Some people saw that as cowardly, right? Malcolm X famously called him the good Dr. Chicken Wing, right? And said that, you know, this was a cowardly act to put women and children in front of brutes and beasts and savages to be brutalized and arrested and beaten in different ways. But here we have this idea here is that nonviolence itself, this social justice and this particular expression is not a method for cowards. It does resist, right? It takes incredible bravery to move forward in the way they did and put their lives at risk in these different ways. Two, does not seek to defeat, and this is interesting here, does not seek to defeat or humiliate the opponent, but to win his friendship with understanding. So this is a different take from some expressions of protest and resistance. So there are people who are very clear, especially during the Black Power movement, certainly in Black nationalist circles, they have no care for the feelings of oppressors, right? In fact, when you go back to Martin Luther King, who in some ways seems to be a foil to Malcolm X. Malcolm X is very clear. You know, he calls white folks all sorts of names. He said, in the Nation of Islam, argues that whites are biologically wicked. They can't help it. And Elijah Muhammad, who was the leader of the Nation of Islam, said, we don't ask why a dog barks, right? We don't ask why a dog licks his genitals, right? And we don't ask the white man why he bombs churches and kills people and stands against humanity. That's his nature. Like a dog's nature is to do what a dog does. The white man's nature is to be a terrorist, to be a mongrel, to be violent, right? So there's no sense. This is very different from what King was talking about, right? So, but this is not, again, what we're talking about. We're talking about King's ideas, right? So now let's look at three. Campaigns are waged against evil rather than those caught up in the system. This again is, you know, saying that there are people who could be reformed, right? There are people who in the system might be cogs in the wheel and might think, in fact, what they do is just and fair, but if the system had been arranged, their behavior would be rearranged, right? That the behavior is being dictated by the system. If your job is to prevent children from playing in this park, you can prevent children from playing in the park. But if the park is open to all people, then the children will play in the park and you still have your job, right? So this idea is that the system itself could be changed and human behavior could be changed. And so this is the idea there. So four, it avoids external violence but also internal violence of spirit. It cannot be consumed by bitterness or hate, right? This idea that you see these people as inexorably evil, immutably evil, right? That this sort of thing can consume your own spirit and that you want to avoid that sort of bitterness, King argues in this form. And finally, the method of nonviolence is based on the conviction that the universe is on the side of justice, right? And I want to say that again, right? There's a hope there. And there's a hopefulness there. And that hope in the 1964 song, when Sam Cooke says a change is going to come, that's what hope is talking. That's what John Hope is a president of Morehouse College. But this is what is being said by Sam Cooke right here in the song. He said, finally, the method of nonviolence is based on the conviction that the universe is on the side of justice, right? The arc of the universe is long, but it bends towards justice. So this idea here is that society itself, with our efforts, not by sitting back and letting just things go, but because of our efforts in the trenches, working on all these different fronts, things will get better, right? A change is going to come. So it's hopeful, all right? All right, so then I want to kind of go through these things here. We're going to get into the meat of the conversation here, looking at the radical imagination of King and different characteristics. Context matters, things are dynamic and fluent, and then we have these core principles that we talked about earlier. I'm going to evade those, not going to discuss those other points here. And so while talk about King from 50, 60 years ago, there's no escaping that all of us in this room have been in our entire lives fed ideas of King. In our entire lives, all of us have heard people quote King. In our entire lives, people have seen people celebrate King in all these ways, right? People who are white, people who are black, people who are conservative, people who are liberal, people who are progressive in different ways, all sorts of people talk about King as a positive, as a good person, as someone who has been a net good for society. And so people on the right and people on the left quote King. This is President Obama in 2011 at the MLK Memorial in Washington, D.C., celebrated King as, quote, quintessentially American. For, quote, ours is a story of optimism and achievement and constant striving that is unique upon this earth. Why are you laughing, Professor? So Obama, you know, the first black president, man. He's saying this is the quintessential King is quintessentially American. This is a hopeful achievement, striving, unique in the history of the planet Earth, right? Human civilizations, thousands of years, and this is uniquely American. What's it called? American exceptionalism, right? So this is what Obama is saying, right? First black president. Can't control your laughter because it seems so absurd, right, to people who know better, right? But that's what Obama said. But people love to hear that. People love to think they're on the good side, right? This is a good thing, right? What did Clinton say? In 1999, he said about Rosa Parks. Rosa Parks brought America home to our founders' dreams, right? George Mason, James Madison, Thomas Jefferson, Franklin, what's this other guy? Thomas Jefferson. Rosa Parks is an embodiment of their dreams, right? Like they were hoping for a day where someone like Rosa Parks would come around and realize their dreams, right? And so Clinton is saying this too. And in some ways, these guys are like, hey, these black folks who fought, this is America. This is what our founding fathers stood for. It is so great to see all this happen, right? So people have been saying all this kind of stuff, right? So at the time, when King was still breathing and King was walking around and King was an activist, like, we have evidence, we have science, this is some social science, we call it, right? What do people say about King? It's not like we can't go to the historical record. You can see, what did people think about Dr. King? Well, he was alive. It turns out that the most sophisticated polling that we had at the time, the Gallup poll, found that 63% of Americans, keep in mind that they're polling Americans, everybody. I'm assuming there's some black people in this group, right? Black people at the time were about 12% of the population. Latinos, maybe 4% of the population. Asian Americans and Native Americans, maybe 1% together. So maybe a 15, 16% of the population of color in 1966. But this is everybody. This is everyone put together. This is the South, the North, East, West, white, black, Asian, Latino, Native American. I'm assuming that everybody is in that group. And with everyone combined, I don't know what it would look like if you took out all the people of color. I don't know. I don't know if it would be higher or lower. My suspicions are that it would probably be a higher rate of a negativity, right? I'm thinking that black people probably, vast majority, were positive when it came to King, right? And I suspect Latinos and Native Americans part two, since he was saying that all of us have access to voting and justice and everything else, right? But at this point, in 1966, almost two-thirds, 66% of Americans gave a negative score of King, right? And the civil rights marches were viewed as a major success. In fact, as you can see from the quotes I have here, that 4% of Americans rated King negatively on that scale in 2011. So when Obama made that comment, at this point, we have 96% of Americans do not see King as negative, right? As opposed to 63%. We see a huge change. You look at 2017, to the point that we're talking about in this lecture today, 2017 poll, CBS showed that 65% of white respondents disapproved of people taking a knee to bring attention to social justice during the NFL games. 65% were hostile to it, and 49%, roughly half, strongly opposed, while the majority of black people, the vast majority, 74% of black respondents approved of taking a knee to bring attention to social justice. And so we see a discordant approach to, in a sense of social justice, in our time, and we could imagine that there was something like that back then. But the takeaway here is that ideas change. And to go back to those pillars I mentioned earlier, part of that is to win people to your side, right? This idea is that people can be reformed, that unlike what the Nation of Islam said, that these people are immutably wicked, that the idea is that that's not the case, that we're all human beings, that people have weaknesses and strengths alike, and that they could be reformed morally. And then now, we're gonna jump into the talk, right? And we have a lot of informed people here. We had some great conversations around hip hop earlier. We have some people who really know their art, know their rappers, and we can play a quick game. I don't know how many people like games. I like games. My kids like games. My son is always trying to have me play a game. So we can play a game here. Who said it? And so we have some quotes. And before we get into our talk now, I know I keep saying before we get into the talk, I keep saying it, but I never do it. But we're going to finally get around to it. So here's like, who said it? I'll start with the first one here. And this is a response. So there were, as we all know, in 2020, we have unprecedented protests, the George Floyd murder all around the country. So while this is going on, they were asking different rappers their opinions on the protests. And one rapper heard this, and he was not supportive. He didn't like the protests. This rapper said, if we want to place the blame on anybody, it should be ourselves, not doing more of what we think we're doing. I know it's not the most articulate expression ever made, but this is with this rapper who did not support Black Lives Matter or anything. Here we have a rapper here, says, I don't want to talk about no effing Ferguson, NS, because I don't live over there. I live in effing Soho and Beverly Hills. There's another rapper, right, saying this. These are rappers who don't like Black Lives Matter, right, who are hostile to the social justice movement. And this other rapper says, there's no such thing as racism. I'm a young, black, rich mother effer. If they don't let you know that America understands black mother effers matter these days, I don't know what it is. That's another quote, right? And then finally, this other rapper said, Black Lives Matter is some bull-ish. We kill each other, unquote. I'm curious. Anybody know that we have ASAP Rocky, we have Drake, Meek Mill, Cardi B, Will Smith, real thuggish Will Smith last night, Lil Wayne, Kevin Gates, and Kanye West. I have a comma there. I should be a period. I could go on with some other people. But anybody want to try? Man, right here.
Number three is Lil Wayne.
Okay. Number three is Lil Wayne. All right. What do you think? Right between Lil Wayne and Meek Mill, number one. Okay. Anybody else want to try? Yep.
Yeah, see, I thought number three was Kanye.
All right. Number three is Kanye. Okay. All right. Man right here.
Is number two Kanye?
Number two, Kanye. Ferguson. All right. I live in Soho and Beverly Hills. Okay. Where else? As a matter of fact, what I'm going to do it this way, let's go through the names. ASAP Rocky. Anybody for ASAP Rocky for any of these four? All right. You think ASAP Rocky for?
Number two.
Number two. All right. You think number two? All right. Anybody else? ASAP Rocky? One try. Okay. Number three for ASAP Rocky. Okay. Let's see. How about for Drake? Drake for anybody? All right.
I think he might be number one.
You think Drake might be number one? Okay. Meek Mill for anybody? All right. Number one? Okay. And then we have Cardi B. Anybody for Cardi B? So y'all give Cardi B a pass. Okay. Will Smith. All right. Will Smith gets a one, two. Lil Wayne. Number three for Lil Wayne. Anybody else? All right, Kevin Gates. All right, number four. What do you say? You don't know, kind of maybe halfway?
Number four.
Number four. BLM is some BS. We kill each other. Okay. How about final Kanye West? Number four. Anyone else with Kanye West? Okay. So check this out. Now pay attention to this talk and you will find out who said what, because I go through all of them in the talk, right? So it'll come up in the talk. All right, so we'll get a chance to see what rappers are saying what about Black Lives Matter. All right, when we think about generations of hip hop, we have different points in which hip hop had been activist oriented. When I was in college, hip hop took a turn towards the political mainstream hip hop. You could turn on the radio, watch MTV. One of the hottest songs of the summer start off with 1989 is a number, another summer, get down to the sound of the funky drummer. And this was Fight the Power. This is like, you know, the idea that you have a song that's a commercial hit that is about resistive politics and activism and black nationalism seems bizarre now, that it would be not marginal underground. You got to find it through your friends, hookups on different, you know, media spaces. But the fact that it would be on MTV, on BET, and on radio is something very different. Also during this period, we have Malcolm X, Black Panthers, the Nation of Islam had been, you know, dominant. And it was a conspicuously black moment in commercial music, late 1960s. Late 1980s, early 1990s. Black nationalism and hip-hop came through a whole bunch of groups, East Coast and West, not just unique to the Northeast. Brand Nubian, the Lynch Mob was from L.A., Brand Nubian from the New York area. X-Clan was probably one of the blackest groups you could ever come across. Eminem shouts out X-Clan and how big they were. And people looked at and quoted from Malcolm X all the time. People, and there are a whole bunch of pictures. In fact, the cover of that book, Hip Hop Revolution, actually is inspired by this very pose. If you look at the cover of the book, we see DJ Lord, who's holding up a turntable as his weapon of choice, peering through a window, the way Malcolm held up the assault rifle peering through the window as his weapon of choice. And so music itself had become this weapon. So this picture right here has been signified by a whole bunch of rappers. This is Boogie Down Productions, By All Means Necessary, of course, to take on Malcolm's By Any Means Necessary quote. And so we see at this point in hip hop, there's a very conspicuous celebration of a black nationalist, more radical permutation. If we go up to Black Lives Matter now, we see a shift actually away from the more militant, in-your-face, sort of fight the power, fuck the police, I can curse in front of everybody here. So we think about how people were very vitriolic, not just, and I'm not, you know, but J. Cole came out with a song called Be Free. Like, in response to all this, his stuff was Be Free. You literally had multiple groups. X-Clan had a group called FTP. FTP, fuck the police. FTP. You had Public Enemy having a video where they actually go and assassinate corrupt police officers. I mean, so it's very different than what we see now, where people are saying, instead of, like, you know, having videos of assassinating corrupt police officers and white supremacists, Ice Cube has a video where the video opens with dead police officers all around him and he's being taken off to prison. So to this idea of, you know, please don't shoot me, like hands up, don't shoot. It's a very different sort of expression of resistance than what we found in earlier permutations. Not saying that this is necessarily bad, I'm not saying it's cowardly or anything, but it's more aligned with the pillars we talked about before, about kind of King's sense of social justice and what we'll find later. And what I want to do now is read a little bit here, and this is a conversation around how hip hop itself has taken on Black Lives Matter in really kind of interesting ways over the last few years. And I want to, this is from a book chapter that looks at Black Lives Matter beyond police killings of unarmed black people and how hip hop engages that, but Black Lives Matter by also looking at the illicit drug trade. So I'm gonna look at how hip hop artists value black lives, but value black lives not just in this one column, but also in the column of how the illicit drug trade has resulted in black lives being destroyed by the people involved in the illicit drug trade as gangsters and drug dealers and the police and the carceral state and the reach of the carceral state, right? So, and as addiction and everything else too, destroy families and all that kind of stuff, right? So we have this a more panoptic view of how black lives are under threat, right, in a particular way. So I'm not gonna talk about the part about the drug trade here for our sake of time, so I'll focus more on the police part. And I'll look at how, in the 21st century, how artists have been grappling with some of these things here. One of the interesting things is that some people may be aware that the war on drugs initiated by Richard Nixon in the early 1970s was a revision of some of the anti-drug policies in the early 20th century. And when Nixon formed the National Commission on Marijuana and Drug Abuse, also known as the Schaefer Commission, it was named after a Republican governor of Pennsylvania. This white male governor of Pennsylvania, Schaefer, he actually assembled all these specialists about drugs. He got these people from all around the country and then all around the world, and they looked at policies all around the world. And this is, keep in mind, this is a Republican governor from Pennsylvania appointed by Richard Milhouse Nixon, right? And they actually looked at the science and they came back and they had a proposal on how drug policy should be formed in the United States of America. To Nixon's chagrin, the Schaefer Commission, after consideration of all the things I just mentioned before, staunchly opposed, actually suggested that marijuana should be legalized. So early 1970s. They proposed to the Nixon administration, the president, that marijuana was not as deleterious as many other drugs that in fact are regulated, alcohol among them, that marijuana was different from cocaine or heroin, and that marijuana could in fact be socially beneficial in terms of tax control of its purity and also mitigating crime and violence of different sorts. This is a proposal. Nixon, however, was staunchly opposed and dismissed entirely the commission's hard work and recommended that there should in fact be an quote-unquote all-out war on marijuana instead. So in direct opposition, Nixon understood that marijuana consumption, particularly among groups that he did not like, anti-war activists and African Americans and folks that he thought there was a good way to selectively police people who use marijuana, and this could be good for him as a politician, that he figured that marijuana should in fact be, there should be an all-out war against it. And he compared it, although he's no physician, although he's not part of this the study, he said it was as destructive as heroin and cocaine. The consequences of Nixon's quote-unquote war on drugs were expansive and devastating for decades. In fact, since his declaration, over 15 million Americans have been arrested in marijuana charges. By 2008, marijuana possession accounted for over half of those arrested for drug crimes. In 2009 alone, 858,000 people were prosecuted for marijuana possessions. The next year, in 2010, the majority of arrests in the nation's largest city, New York, were for marijuana possession, which also accounted for over 80% of the increase of drug arrests between 1980s and 2007. So when states like Colorado, Arizona, Michigan, Massachusetts, Washington, and California moved to legalize or decriminalize marijuana in the first decade of the 21st century, the New York City Police Department, this is interesting, so when those states were decriminalizing, New York Police Department in the same period actually placed marijuana as centerpiece of anti-crime initiatives and at the point when violent crime was dropping to its lowest rates ever in the city. This policy had been so extreme the first decade of the 21st century that more people were arrested in New York City on charges of marijuana possession in 1 year. I'll have to repeat that because it's hard to comprehend. More people were arrested on marijuana charges in 1 year, in 2010, than the entire 19-year period between 1978 and 1996. This is how expansive. Simultaneously, New York City had a stop and frisk campaign where over 90%+ of people being stopped and frisked. And when you get hundreds of thousands of people, over 500,000 people in a year being stopped and frisked, of course you can find some people who have little bits of marijuana which allow them to arrest people, right? And so even as this, you could go to some other state and be completely fine and not be put in prison or jail for anything, people are being put in jail again, getting arrested or having citations of different sorts for it. And finally, what is striking about this is that blacks and Latinos represent 52% of the city, but they represented 83% of those people arrested, and studies show that white and black and Latinos consume marijuana consumption at the same rates. So you see this huge discordant rate in which this happened. And finally, with the election of de Blasio as mayor, stop and frisk decreased, hundreds of thousands of people were not arrested, and I have all these numbers and data that I won't bore you with right here. So we think about the war on drugs, one of the things that we find in hip-hop is that people were making all sorts of commentary about hip-hop and its obsession with drugs and the celebration of the illicit drug trade. And this became part of the conversations around Black Lives Matter. But the 21st century, in our period here, I want to talk a little bit about how hip-hop has taken a turn. Since the 1990s, there has been a steep decline in the crack cocaine trade in Black communities. Despite the decline of actual drug dealing in Black communities in the 21st century, the trade continues to be a central trope in commercial rap, even as it offers a narrow view of the effects in the Black community. Themes have so dominated commercial hip-hop in the last few years that a list of the most popular songs from A$AP Rocky's Peso, 2014, through Fetty Wap's Trap Queen, OT Genesis' Coco, Future's Mask Off, Migos, and Lil Uzi Vert's Bad and Bougie, Playboi Carti's song. So many songs have been a constant narrative of the most myopic tales of expensive cars, killing ninjas, and misogynistic tales of the most coarse sexual conquest. In general, crack-themed songs, often called trap music, have generated a heated debate among others in the hip-hop community about the direction of rap music itself. Many have argued that the core political thrust of rap music has taken a stark turn away from the themes that are essentially antisocial, particularly in the African-American community. This is notable given that whites and blacks sell drugs at the same rate, and in recent years, the white community consumes illicit drugs at a higher rate than the black community. The central celebration of drug use and drug selling in commercial rap is grossly discordant with the actual lived experience of the vast majority of black people. Many have argued that these rappers have chosen to pander to the most hostile, wider consumer markets' thirst and eagerness for coarse black stereotypes as minstrelsy. And many rappers I discuss have talked about these characters. What I want to do now is quickly shift to talk about Black Lives Matter and how Black Lives Matter has grappled with the police in particular outside the drug trade in hip-hop. From 2014 BET Hip Hop Awards show to the 2015 Grammy Awards and the 2015 Academy Awards, rappers like Kendrick Lamar performed live with Hands Up, Don't Shoot Pose. Whether explicitly or formally tied to Black Lives Matter, hip-hop has been intimately engaged with activist politics in recent years, even as commercial music rarely reflects the political currents found outside the studio. Chance the Rapper called the movement, quote, important and integral to our advancement as a people, while seasoned MCs Talib Kweli, Killer Mike, and Common have explicitly endorsed Black Lives Matter as well. Interestingly, other rappers who have enjoyed commercial success for their anti-Black narratives, like some of the ones I mentioned before, have criticized their peers and activists for denouncing white supremacy and demanding social justice. In 2016, multiple gangster rappers denounced Black Lives Matter. They denounced the movement for Black Lives and have denounced social justice activities in general. Most notably, Harlem rapper A$AP Rocky told journalists, quote, I don't want to talk about no fucking Ferguson and shit because I don't live over there. I live in fucking Soho and Beverly Hills. I can't relate. In a similarly dismissive way, similarly dismissing any affinity to the interests of the wider Black community, Lil Wayne, who earlier insisted that, quote, there is no such thing as racism, denounced Black Lives Matter. Quote, I'm a young, Black, rich motherfucker, the New Orleans MC argued. Quote, if they don't let you know that America understand Black motherfuckers these days, I don't know what it is, unquote. Despite his hometown being one of the most violent cities burdened by drugs, police corruption, and poverty, he noted, quote, I don't feel connected to a damn thing that ain't got nothing to do with me. If you do, you crazy as shit, unquote. Similarly, rapper Kevin Gates, based in Gary, Indiana, one of the most violent, impoverished cities in the country, called the movement for Black Lives some bullshit and argued that police terror was a ridiculous concern since we kill each other, unquote. In many ways, A$AP Rocky, Lil Wayne, and Gates have reflected the political sentiments of most of their fan base, which are likely white males. In fact, whites have been the majority consumers of rap music since its mainstream crossover in the early 1990s. Simultaneously, most whites, as polls have shown earlier, view movements for social action for social justice and Black lives with deep hesitation and outright hostility. In fact, just 35% of whites had a favorable view of Black Lives Matter in the most recent NFL protests taking a knee to bring attention to social justice. While risking alienation from a wider and more profitable white fan base, some rappers have addressed their anti-Black Lives Matter peers. As if in direct reply to Kevin Gates, MC Lil Durk, who is a Black Lives Matter tattoo, explained that crime in the Black community is, in fact, a crisis, but that it also should be, and it should be addressed. Quote, Lil Durk says, killing happens everywhere. It happens, but it's not supposed to happen by the people who are supposed to protect us, unquote. T.I., the Atlanta-based rapper, responded directly to his fellow Southern rapper Lil Wayne by demanding that, quote, stop embarrassing yourself and everyone out here who's been supporting you. There is no middle ground. Oppression knows no neutral party. Either you're part of the oppressed or you're part of the oppressor, unquote. In the spring of 2020, with an unprecedented groundswell of protests against police killings of Black people as it swept the country, this followed the high-profile deaths of Ahmaud Arbery, Breonna Taylor, and George Floyd. And without getting into all these cases here, these all happened, and these cases in some ways reflected a famous case in 2013 of a little girl, Ayanna Stanley Taylor, who was killed in Detroit with a no-knock raid, and it mirrored the Breonna Taylor case. In this case, Breonna Taylor was shot 8 times. Police found no drugs in the home. No officers were initially charged. As we know, in the last few weeks, one of the officers was acquitted. The one that was charged was actually acquitted. We know the case of Floyd. After this, multiracial crowds poured into Minneapolis streets immediately after the killing of George Floyd. And all this is stuff we know, so I have to get into great detail here. We have multiracial crowds, we have unprecedented crowds. The protests spread from Minneapolis all across to other cities in the country in the first 3 days. Within 5 days, demonstrations occurred in all 50 states as whites, blacks, Latinx, Asians, and Native people occupied streets. Despite violent demonstration and urban unrest in several cities, the vast majority, over 93%, according to some studies, as high as 98% in others, these events were peaceful, but militant and bold. Black Lives Matter placards and demands to stop killing Black people were ubiquitous, even in the hands of white demonstrators. Hip-hop artists were immediate in their direct involvement. Carol Mike and T.I. joined Atlanta Mayor Keisha Lance Bottoms to call for justice and end to police terror, and simultaneously an end to civil unrest, especially in Atlanta. New York-based rapper Papoose released a revision of his 2004 classic, Alphabetical Slaughter, on June 5th. creatively listing the names of from A to Z of the many victims of police violence. It's a 5-minute tribute to the Black Lives Matter, and it starts with the 1999 killing of Amadou Diallo, and poetically lists people through every letter to the letter Z. Every name of Black men, and importantly, Black women, like Breonna Taylor and Sandra Bland, provides details about each case involving an incessant pattern of acquittals of officers. The powerful song was one of several released by MCs, from Meek Mill to YG, T Grizzly, addressing police violence against Black people in the last few years. Among rap heavyweights, J. Cole, Jay-Z spoke out against the killings of Breonna Taylor, George Floyd in late May. Several rappers, including Lil Yachty, Trey the Truth, Nick Cannon, My Song Visit, Minneapolis, joining demonstrators against police terror. Bun B, the Houston-based rapper and affiliate of DJ Screw, also personally knew Floyd years earlier and traveled to Minneapolis. Kanye West, Sadat X, Wale, Kendrick Lamar, Vic Mensa, Big Sean, Ludacris, other high-profile rappers joined demonstrations across the country. White rappers like R.A. the Rocket Man, Machine Gun Kelly, Eminem expressed outrage over police terror through social media and marches as well. Social media posts from veterans, Ice Cube, Ice-T, Snoop Dogg, as well as Cardi B, Chance the Rapper, and too many to list here, have become involved and discussed these things with great passion and visual outrage at what they had seen before them. And on May 30th, music's first billionaire reached out, in his billionaire status from New York City, reached out to the governor personally, and the governor, Tim Walz, stressing, quote, the need that justice be served. And that billionaire was Jay-Z. These sustained marches, demonstrations, and calls for justice were not in vain. They were unprecedented. They, in fact, exceeded what we'd ever seen in the 1960s. They exceeded everything we'd ever seen in the 1950s. Nothing like this had happened in the history of the United States of America. After 10 consecutive days of protests, including looting and arson in several cities, lawmakers across the country responded with new measures on policing. I can't get into all these right now, but I'll just read a few. Minneapolis eventually arrested all four officers in the Floyd case and charged Chauvin with second-degree murder. Demands for policy changes, accountability, and defunding of police spread. Minneapolis banned police chokeholds, and then on June 7th, a veto-proof majority of the city council pledged to defund the police department. California Governor Gavin Newsom demanded that all police agencies in the state ban chokeholds. L.A. Mayor Eric Garcetti on June 4th, 2020, defunded the L.A. Police Department, second largest police department in the country, up to $150 million and reallocated it to invest in Black communities and communities of color. The mayor of the District of Columbia, Morel Browser, a Black woman, renamed the street leading to the White House Black Lives Matter Plaza. After 12 days, protests spread to London, Paris, Tokyo, and beyond. While hip-hop artists have been visible in a wide range of ways, they were not universally committed to the demand that Black Lives Matter or what police accountability looked like. Lil Wayne doubled down. I would say that he doubled down on his coonery. I know I shouldn't have said that. He doubled down on his 2016 stance. I read something wrong here, my apologies here. He doubled down his 2016 stance against Black Lives Matter, reiterating that a white cop, when people asked him, they said, Lil Wayne, I stand by what I said. He said, he shot himself in the chest back in the day. He said, when I shot myself, the person who came to my aid, the cop that came to my aid was a white one. And that white man pulled me out. He said, so why y'all talk about all this Black Lives Matter stuff? So that's a Lil Wayne story. He's sticking to it. He said, if we want to place blame on anybody, we should be blaming ourselves for not doing more than we think we're doing. The 37-year-old rapper went on to explain that people put out a tweet and think they're doing something. Well, many on social media blasted Lil Wayne for going, quote unquote, and this is a real quote, not me. Many on social media blasted Lil Wayne saying he went full coon, unquote, for supplications to corrupt police and evincing a cowardly, spineless stance in the face of brazen brutality against Black people. His politics, to some extent, reflect the current hip-hop itself, no matter how marginal it may be. Everyone is not an advocate for Black people's uplift, even in the Black community. Everyone is not an advocate for social justice, even in the Black community. Everyone is not even an advocate for police accountability, even in the Black community. It is in this broader context of debate, discussion, and creative tension that rappers have made important connections to Black Lives Matter movement, keeping the names of victims of police violence alive, circulating long before the groundswell of 2020. In fact, it was a constant work of rap artists that reminded millions that black life had been brutally and openly subjugated to police terror. The brutal behavior was long documented in hip-hop before Floyd's death. Anyone who is familiar with hip-hop going back to the 1980s is very well aware of this sort of on-the-ground reporting from hip-hop artists. And I actually have a couple videos here that that talk to some of this, and I'm not going to get a chance to do all that because I want to have some time for some Q&A here, and I know that I want to keep that up. But one of the things that's kind of fascinating here is that we think about millennials and this period is that it's increasingly multicultural, right? When we think about hands up, don't shoot, is that much of the sort of the romantic views of the Black Panther Party, of Malcolm X, and some of the militancy of the late 1960s that we saw in the late 80s and early 90s, a lot of that had not been that apparent, but the activism far exceeds what we saw in the early 1990s. There's nothing like this in the 1990s. People taking the streets of thousands. When Rodney King's beaters were acquitted, I mean, you had LA and you had actually Atlanta, a moderate outburst in Atlanta. So you had two cities in 1992, right? But this is something we've seen in an unprecedented scale. All of it, of course, has not been peaceful along the principles that we talked about before. Of course, we did have this. And this picture is a picture of contrast, right? We have violence, of course, and you have the destruction of property in the background with someone, of course, the hands up, don't shoot. Just the idea, like my hands are up, I pose no threat to you, my palms are facing you, do not murder me, right? Do not kill me, my hands up, don't shoot, that we have this. And of course, we've had this take off across different spaces. Politicians, of course, is Congressional Black Caucus and congressional aides in Washington, D.C. And we think about MCs, there's, you know, we talked about the beauty, the talent, and the brilliance of someone like Kendrick Lamar, who engages this in his song, All Right. We Gonna Be All Right, in many ways, has become an anthem for the Black Lives Matter movement. Across the United States, there are people who are chanting this. There are videos on YouTube of crowds chanting, We Gonna Be All Right. There's a movie, a TV show called The Quad on BET, where they have the students involved in some protests, and their students do what they do in real life. They start chanting, We Gonna Be All Right. They go back to Kendrick's song. And Kendrick's song goes back to that principle that we saw in the Kingian ideas there, those five pillars, that the arc of the universe is long, but bends towards justice, right? When Sam Cooke says a change is going to come, we have Kendrick Lamar saying, you know, if God got us, I may be messed up, you may be messed up, if God got us, we're going to be all right, right? This idea that we will be all right, that we will prevail, that justice will in fact prevail. This idea that hands up, don't shoot, social justice, that as Kendrick Lamar weaves very, I think, in a fascinating way, prisons, crime, violence, the violence we see in the Black community, when his critiques of all these different things, ultimately we're in power, the people themselves have faith, they will be all right. We see this with rappers going all the way back. We have people that I've mentioned in here, Chance the Rapper, we have Sean, we have Big Sean, we have my man J. Cole right here, and we have people in Congress, right? We could go through the list of people who made the gesture and it was very important. And we have people in Barcelona, these are students over in Europe, of course, who are doing it. We have civil rights activists like Fannie Hamer, right? A Mississippian, Fannie Hamer, who had been desperately poor, who had fought for justice, fought for civil rights, marched for this, had been arrested, had been beaten, and testified in front of Congress and talked about this, but she had faith again that the people will prevail. It goes all the way back to some of the fundamental principles of Kingian notions of social justice, and we see that alive in Black Lives Matter today. I'll leave you with that. Sorry for talking so fast. I think I have time for Q&A. Dr. Chavis? Okay. Well, okay. I could go right here. There are a couple of videos. This one actually, believe it or not, the chapter that I have that I read from, and I look at how hip-hop is gauged two forms of activities that have been hostile to Black life, right? Police killings of unarmed Black folk. Then I look at the illicit drug trade, and I look at how rappers are critiquing the drug trade, but also overly punitive responses to the trade. And you see when I talk about marijuana possession. So in Connecticut now, marijuana is like, it's dropped all the way down. It's like a very light crime. Massachusetts is like decriminalized in Massachusetts. It's like a recreational drug in many places, right? So, but keep in mind that we've had over 15 million people have been arrested for marijuana. This video here is a wonderful video. It's J. Cole, Crooked Smile. Anyone who's familiar with J. Cole knows that his art will sometimes offer, his songs will offer two different texts. So there may be a visual text, although I went from my mouth, so a lyrical text to a song, and then a visual text, and the two may be discordant, right? So if you look at GOMD, you can hear the song, the video is a very different narrative. If you hear Crooked Smile, the video is a different narrative. So J. Cole is really cool that he's offering you, you know, two for your buck, right? So he's getting two for one. And right here, so the video doesn't always go along with the lyrics. You get a chance to see a whole new story. And this is a short movie. It comes off as a short movie in the beginning. We won't do the whole thing. I'll jump forward. But starts off with this. And opens up innocuous enough, doing something we all do in the morning. And it goes over to this guy. And there's an interesting sort of parallel of two men starting their day. One white, one black, doing the things that people do, sort of shared humanity, so early on. And we have him, J. Cole, very non-threatening, out there starting his day, smiling. So the song is about, like, you know, self-love and all this kind of stuff. And the video has this white guy with his kid. This is J. Cole getting his day started, picking out shoes. But look also what he puts out. Some weed. And this guy looks at his DEA badge. Turns out that J. Cole, the protagonist here, is a weed man. And he sells little bits of weed. That's his house. And this is really cool, very well done. It's very subtle, not very over the top. And check him out when he sees his little girl. Oh, I'm sorry. And when he sees his little girl, you see the American flag on his shirt, an upside down black and white American flag. The back of his shirt is all American. And so you do this in many ways, a suburban, all American life. And I asked my students at UConn, how many people know someone who, I say, you don't need to snitch on anybody, but I say, how many people know a UConn student who smokes weed, right? I've asked this question for years. And one year I had an older student, a non-traditional older student who lived off campus, who's married. That's the only time I ever had anyone who did not know a UConn student who smoked weed. Like, every hand goes up every single semester, every single class. And I asked a question, like, how many people will expect that these people will see jail time, will be in prison? How many people will be stopped and frisked? Right? How many people thrown against a wall? Right? How many people will be expelled from school? And there's no sense that's an imminent threat. So this video right here has the two men in different communities of friends dealing with different things, although they start off. And this seems very, very placid. Ultimately, they raid his house. They come in with a whole full military raid. want to just pause this right here so you can see the name. They have it briefly before it's covered up. All right, for Ayanna Stanley Jones. And so I'm going to read this paragraph here regarding this video. So thank you, Dr. Chavis, for allowing me to discuss this particular one. Actually, I'll start the chapter off by giving you a narrative of what happened with Ayanna Stanley Jones. A little after midnight on May 16th, 2010, Detroit police officers conducted a raid at 4054 Lillibridge Street, located in the city's east side, in search of a murder suspect, Chauncey Owens. Owens was wanted for the murder of Jean Blake, a high school senior who was shot and killed 2 days earlier. A special response team fired a flash grenade through the window immediately before the raid. Officer Joseph Weekly, the first one through the door, opened fire on a single figure on a sofa, killing a 7-year-old girl, Ayanna Stanley Jones, who was sleeping next to her grandmother, Bertilla Jones. Weekly claimed his weapon discharged when the girl's grandmother grabbed it. Jones confirmed she had no contact at all with the officer. Subsequent tests on the gun revealed no fingerprints from Mrs. Jones. Adding to the horror of the child's death is the fact that the assault team fired the grenade into the wrong apartment. All right. Weekly was, after protests, was arrested and acquitted. Importantly, J. Cole's corpus of work intersects neatly with the wider currents of Black Lives Matter, addressing the deleterious consequences and the reach of the carceral state and its quote-unquote war on drugs in the Black community, while simultaneously addressing the limits of viewing drug dealing as romantic, cool, and without its own horrifying effects. The visual text for this video we just saw, Crooked Smile, offers a powerful commentary on multiple themes in hip hop and concerns around social justice. That a relatively innocuous drug, marijuana, would merit the aggressive weight of a militarized DEA raid on a home occupied by a lone, unarmed, low-level dealer is itself notable. That the same raid will result in the unintended death of a child also speaks to the degree to which police officers, through poor training, malfeasance, or ineptitude, or a mix of all three, combine to kill an unarmed child who will pose no lethal threat to the officers. Finally, the urgency of ending these killings and seeking justice for the victims remains a foundation for the rise of Black Lives Matter movement itself, reflecting the core politics of the wider Black community. And so one of the things, I hate to have such a somber note here, but one of the things that's kind of interesting is that when we talk about keeping names alive, that, you know, that J. Cole did this movie and it's such a poignant video because it's not a sort of, it's not an easy one with the cops as bad guys, right? It's not like they came in with the intention to murder this child. But you keep in mind the five pillars of hip hop, you remember looking at not the people as evil, but a system. So imagine if this is not legal. If you can do no-knock raids, that girl would have been dead, right? If you don't arrest people for marijuana, that kid would have been dead. They wouldn't have been raiding them, right? So we understand that there's a system here and you see a humanization of even the white cop, right? You see him doing the same thing. And it turns out their girls were friends in the same class. So there's a humanity of the child, there's a humanity of the cop, and you see, you know, black and white cops going this, and the cop wasn't flippant about killing the child, right? That there seems to be some sort of shock even there. But this idea that it intersects, again, very neatly with these principles of social justice that we've seen articulated by Kingian ideas from the modern civil rights movement. And we see these sorts of themes throughout hip-hop and Black Lives Matter in the last several years, which have been really fascinating to discuss this as a true in fact movement, and a movement that more mirrors what we saw in the 1960s than we often take at first glance.
Thank you so much, Dr. Ogbar. This time we'll take some questions from the audience, a few questions. So go right ahead. I know y'all got some questions.
Yeah, I got a question. So what role do you think the Latino community plays in the Black Lives Matter movement?
It's really good. So Cardi B has been outspoken, and you know, she's talked about these issues, you know, donated money, marched, tweeted, that kind of stuff. It's interesting when I think about like some rappers like Tekashi 6ix9ine and Lil Pump, who are like Lil Wayne, you know, they like just, you know, don't seem to be interested, you know, at all. And I don't think this is an issue about blackness. I think that they would be not interested if it was Brown Lives Matter, you know. I don't think that they seem to be interested in social justice in general. And I think that they reflect the same sorts of ideological diversity that we find in the African American community, you know. And it is kind of interesting because we have Fat Joe in a different issue back with Hurricane Katrina in 2005. Fat Joe had given large sums of money and was a supporter of people who had been who lost so much in Hurricane Katrina, largely African Americans in a different city where he's not even from. And Fat Joe was like one of the more generous rappers, you know. So there are these like really cool intersections you find in different places with Latino rappers and African American ones. Yes, sir.
I was really struck. First of all, wanted to talk. Thank you. So excited.
Thank you.
But one of the things I was struck by when I was looking at J. Cole's video, "Crooked Smile," was sort of palimpsest sort of feel it had in the video, where there were these multiple levels, right? So you say, Dr. Ogbar, that there is a kind of disjunction between the video and the music itself, but there's also this kind of disjunction between the playing of the Star Spangled, the national anthem, right, in the background, and the video. And one of the things that was interesting to me as a person who does work in 19th century, and was curious to find out what sense you make of it, was why was that song being played at the moment it was being played, given that it was penned by a person who was pro-slavery,
that's a good point.
Not an abolitionist, and he's talking about the defense of the Republic against British imperial aggression.
And talks about slaves, because all these people who are escaping slavery to fight for the British so they can get their freedom. He's mad at that.
Yeah, so what's happening here? What is the kind of modern commentary that you think that the Star Spangled Banner J. Cole is doing projected forward toward this thing about police aggression? Or is that something that...
Yeah. So, Stuart Hall? Stuart Hall is the one that has encoding and decoding. You know, he talks about, you know, critical theory, you know, cultural studies. And so this is a really good example of encoding and decoding. Like, so when we, for all of us here, so Stuart Hall was he was Jamaican, but was based in Britain, and a cultural theorist. And he talked about how all of us, when we see art, we decode it based on our own sensitivities and subjectivities, right? But it's encoded by the artist. And it may be the same, but it may be different, right? So you may take something that the artist didn't intend. So when we think about J. Cole's video, and from my own particular take, is I don't know if J. Cole was aware of the origins of Star Spangled Banner, if he knows all this stuff, right? But we all know that the Star Spangled Banner is associated with America, Americana. And that is weaved throughout the video visually, right? So the text is talking about love yourself, and you might have a crooked smile or nose or whatever, but you know, this is what you have. But the video itself, you have fire. It looks like it's summertime. It looks like this may be the 4th of July. It looks like, and this is interesting that he puts this at a possible summertime gathering with the fireworks on the 4th of July, and we do all the traditional things, family, barbecue, and all that. And it's very Americana. But we also know what else is very Americana, right? And even as we celebrate, you know, Land of the Free and Home of the Brave, they sang that song even as people were enslaved, right? So Land of the Free, you know, go on, boy, and pick me some cotton, right? And so it's this idea that there's a very kind of palpable incongruence, right? This disconnect between what you say and what you do, what you celebrate and what you actually do. But even in this case, like, you have like a whole military raid, like a militarized raid on the home for a low-level nonviolent drug dealer, right? In a Land of the Free and Home of the Brave, where more people are locked up than any country on planet Earth. And so countries that we think of, like North Korea, that you're less likely to be in prison in North Korea or, you know, Dubai or Turkey or Syria than you are in the United States of America, right? So in Putin's Russia right now, you're more likely to be free than in the United States of America because of this hypercarceral state. And we're talking about more than China, right? And in raw numbers, but also as a percentage. And so he's kind of having this critique of America's incongruence, right? That we have this long incongruence. That's how I kind of read it. But again, Stuart Hall's, I'm decoding it from my own subjectivities. And I remember I was joking with some friends here. Y'all know Parliament Funkadelic, One Nation Under Groove. And so for young people here, like One Nation Under a Groove, getting down just for the funk of it. And they have all this cover art in their albums, and they have the Mothership Connection. They talk about Chocolate City, and they have a reenactment of Iwo Jima raising the flag, right? But the flag they're raising is the green, black, and red, right? And they're like raising the green, black, and red flag, one nation under groove, the 1970s. I'm like, this is all black power, right? The mothership connection coming to Swing Low, Sweet Chariot, going back to some old, like, you know, slave songs, freeing people, seeing yourself attached to the Hebrews, being freed by God. And I see this as a very black nationalist, black power. I'm like, how can you avoid? And by the way, the Nation of Islam used to argue there's a mothership that Allah had created that was in the sky that would come and free everybody, right? So I'm like, mothership connection, green, black, and red, raising green, black, and red flags, chocolate city, one nation, black nation, all that. Turns out that the real story behind it is that they did a concert one time and someone came out, was like, oh man, everybody was a fan. And said everybody was grooving. They're talking to one of the, I think to George Clinton. They're like, man, we had a great time. Mr. Clinton, it was a ball. Man, it was like everybody was grooving. It was like one nation under groove. And they're like, oh, cool, that's a song. And that's how you did it. It had nothing to do with anything I thought it was, right? So all these years, I've always seen this as a particular way because of my own decoding, right? And so we have to be kind of careful about stuff. Because it just seems super obvious to me. I was like, this has to be a black nationalist anthem, right? But it had nothing to do with black nationalism. It had nothing to do with the concept I thought it did. It was completely unattached. And so I don't know what's going on here. You know, I know that sometimes believing certain things I felt better thinking that it was the political stuff that I had, not that it was just some random fan coming out saying it was like we're all grouping like one nation. I don't know if that like kind of answers your question, but it's hard to kind of always discern.
It does. I mean, you know, obviously as a as a lit person, you know, the difference between meaning and intention can be why, right? I mean, you can have discursive possibilities in a text like this. That the person doesn't intend. And I was just so struck by the fact that here comes the FBI coming in to defend the Republic really against this black body. Right? And then you got the song in the background and they're coming in to arrest J. Cole. So it was, I don't know, it was just a very powerful moment.
It's interesting because I pulled this Papoose song up because Papoose starts, I kind of three different versions of the alphabetical slaughter, but alphabetical slaughter 2 starts off with him teaching a class, and this song, the Star Spangled Banner, is actually being sung. So, but this is a different video, so I'm not going to do all that right now. Yes, sir.
So, with this being like DuBois focused, right, and you know talking about hip hop, I do find. DuBois is double consciousness, right? And having to revisit that whole thought process and what does it mean for, you know, given the context of hip hop, because now we're talking about an intergenerational conflict. There's a one generation that may view hip hop in a very nearly negative assignment to some of the issues that we're talking about in the black community, things like that. And now another generation where, you know, it's more popular now, it's considered the most popular music in the country. Our viewpoint of hip hop is a little different, but even to your point, it is still mostly consumed by white males. So for the current age students, right, who are looking at hip hop as like good or bad, how do you think that double consciousness weaves into, you know, this is my favorite rapper, but they're also saying this thing about Black Lives Matter.
I love Lil Wayne, but also love Black Lives Matter.
Right.
Like, I love black people, but I also love Lil Wayne.
Right. So, how does somebody, you know, with fame, like, I'm a fan, but also I feel these things. How does somebody, you know?
So, that's a great question. Thank you so much for that question. So, when I was writing this book, I actually believed that the turn to hip-hop had taken place already, right? This turn towards a more the dominant celebration of pathology, right? Like no adult male rapper had gone platinum without calling women B's or H's since 1999, right? And this is crazy. So I was seeing hip hop, like, you know, you could be a huge fan of Big Daddy Kane and Rakim or Run DMC, and they never called women B's or H's. And no one thought they were bubblegum because they weren't misogynistic, right? But no one is like that now. Like even J. Cole, you know, all these songs, they called women B's and H's, like a normative thing. And I remember seeing this switch happen. I didn't understand talking about the drug trade was one thing. And the earlier narratives around the drug trade, show people like Love's Gonna Get You by KRS-One, where people did drugs or sold drugs, but there were negative consequences, right? You saw them get, you know, go to jail and all that and stuff. You look at Migos and them, and they just like, you know, it's like, great. You just sell drugs and you ride off into the sunset with a whole bunch of money. It's wonderful, right? You got B's and H's and you can sell crack. OT Genesis is like, I'm in love. And the whole thing is like, I just love selling crack. It gives me so much joy. It gives me so much pleasure. So much happiness. I love it, right? And it's like this celebration, which is very different. So when I started seeing hip-hop take this turn, I literally thought, this is what I was thinking. I said, well, I'm going to find, when I look at the data, that the African-American community collectively has increases of violence. I thought the anti-intellectualism, that you have higher rates of dropouts from high school and, of course, lower rates of finishing undergrad. I thought you would have higher rates of teen pregnancy, all these different things. Turns out, and I have a whole chapter on this, it's chapter 4. The whole chapter looks at these data and finds, in fact, that this generation of African Americans, at the time this book came out, in the mid-2000s, that the high school graduation rate was the highest ever, the college graduation rate, the rate at which people got advanced degrees, highest ever. The black homicide rate, whenever I tell people this, people are shocked by it. And this book came out in 07, so it was looking at data probably from 05, but the rate has dropped even further. So 2016, I know we have an officer, a former officer of the law here, knows these data, that the black homicide rate, in fact, had fallen to the lowest level since the CDC. The CDC has data from 1950, beginning in 1950. The black homicide rate had gone down past the lowest rate that we have documented from 1950, right? And when I tell people that, people are always surprised. It doesn't mean that our rates aren't higher than the national average, like our high school dropout rates. Oh, teenage pregnancy rates, the lowest ever, right? Since they've been keeping records on black teenage pregnancy. I found that teenage pregnancy, there are three different studies looking at how men, white, black men in particular, one of those studies looks at white, black, and Latino men, and how they look at gender and look at gender equality. And it turns out that all those studies done over a 10-year span, that black men are more likely to endorse traditional feminist values than other men. Although hip-hop is super misogynistic, right? But I always tell people that whoever your favorite rapper is, Lil Uzi Vert, he's not the embodiment of black manhood through the history of the United States. And so if you were to take a scale and weigh all the songs ever created by African Americans since the 19th century, and then look at hip hop, and look about all the songs and all the creative art that black people have done, that art has not fixated on destroying black people or having contempt for women, right? That's actually not, this is so aberrant to the great expression of the body of the work. So then the question is that it seems to be, and my conclusion was that as much as I might not like it, to make that distinction, like I love black people, but I also like Lil Wayne. And so that people, it seems to my chagrin, I guess it's good, I shouldn't be mad. It seems that people are much smarter than I had given them credit for. That people could literally listen to someone who is anti-black, anti-woman, and be pro-black and feminist. It seems strange, but the facts on the ground show that you could go back to before hip-hop and the homicide rate was higher, right? Drug consumption, I mean, you could go through all these different things. I don't know about drug consumption being higher, but certainly for violence and a whole bunch of other things that we see as bad. And I always argue that, the last thing I'll say is that people have always blamed black music for social ills. They did it for jazz, they did it for rock and roll. It's not surprising that they're doing it for hip-hop. And so this idea that is that powerful, that people are so dumb, they see someone with pelvic thrust and think, oh, I know God impregnated a whole bunch of women, that this is really not how people aren't that impressionable, right? And I think at the end of the day, is when I look, I have a whole thing here on what people were saying about jazz music a 100 years ago. And they said jazz is all this, but they became the greatest generation. Those people consumed jazz. And then the people they said about rock and roll, they became the civil rights generation, you know? So there's a lot to be said about the discordant ways of, you could love black people and still like someone like Lil Wayne as your favorite MC. It could be, it happens, yeah.
Thank you all so much for coming. Let's give Dr. Ogbar a round of applause.
Thank you.
I think I know a lot of you, but not everyone, so in case you don't know me, I'm Dr. Berger. I'm the Associate Director of the African and African American Studies Program. We are so grateful that you came to hear this fantastic lecture, and we are so blessed that Dr. Ogbar is here to autograph books. So please hang around for about 30 more minutes to chat and to get a book signed. Thank you for coming.